Hey, mushroom nerds, it's Anna McHugh. I have a collection of Amanita mushrooms that I want to share with you today, talk to you a little bit about the specific ones that I found, but also a little bit about Amanita identification in general, because I highly recommend that if you are going to get started in mushroom hunting, that you should learn to recognize the Amanita genus with a great deal of confidence, sort of right out of the gate. It's a safety thing more than anything else. So one of the specimens that I have is one of the reasons to get started in mushroom hunting with an understanding of how to recognize and avoid Amanitas. So this is Amanita bisporigera, also known as the destroying angel mushroom. So very dramatic. There are a number of different species that are called destroying angels, but they are all, you know, these beautiful sort of white mushrooms. You have a very distinctive cup of tissue at the base, oftentimes with a little, you know, split. It's very attractive and very consistent. There's also like a little bit of a pinch here at the top. It's really just sort of a, you know, a graceful looking mushroom. It also, this one has a little bit of damage from insects. A good example here of why, you know, wildlife oftentimes can eat mushrooms that are not good for human digestion. So just because you have a mushroom that's being eaten by bugs or mammals does not mean that it's safe. But you know, you, in addition to this stem base, you have skirt and ring on the stem. It's very delicate and very beautiful and, you know, sort of floofy and soft, and white gills. And then, you know, a mushroom that is essentially white overall. So destroying angels will, you know, really make you very, very ill. They can be deadly. Basically, they can, you know, shut your liver down and do a great deal of kidney damage as well. So learning Amanitas is very important because, you know, destroying angels, Amanita phalloides, the death cap mushroom, all are mushrooms you want to avoid. So, you know, getting to know these cap and stem common mycorrhizal species that grow in our forests is really, you know, a valuable exercise. As you begin to do that, however, if you're into mushroom hunting, chances are you're going to almost immediately read that, you know, Amanita identification is very much contingent upon, in part, what is at the base of the stem. And so, you know, typically when you're talking about basic safety, you're talking about this cup of tissue at the base that is very, very common for, you know, destroying angels and additionally Amanita phalloides and its, you know, death cappy relatives. But there are a lot of other Amanitas that have really significant material at the base, but it's very, very radically different from the, you know, the cup of tissue I was just showing you, or what you would hear, like if you're talking to mycologists or reading books, that would be a volval stem base. And, you know, it's essentially a cup of tissue. In this case, this is a mushroom that bears a very striking resemblance to Amanita muscaria. So as far as field identification, I'm going to call this probably Amanita pantherina group-ish. So the reason I say that is it, you know, again, bears very striking resemblance to Amanita muscaria and also Amanita pantherina. Pantherina is a European species. And so, you know, I definitely have to do more research to be comfortable with what this mushroom is with any degree of certainty. But if you look at it, you're like, well, it is an Amanita insofar as it has like a very large amount of tissue at the base, but it is not a cup, it is all attached. And so what you'll see in the case of Amanita muscaria and its relatives, so, you know, Amanita pantherina group, Amanita gemmata is another one. The gemmed Amanita is really beautiful and yellowish. In North Carolina, we have Amanita muscaria vargesowi, which is a beautiful version of Amanita muscaria that is, instead of being sort of a dark reddish color, it is much more red and yellow toned. So, you know, you get this sort of sunshiny yellow Amanita muscaria. It's very, very pretty. But, you know, the thing that distinguishes these, you know, species is that they have a stem base that has these concentric zones on it. So you have a couple of sort of rolls of tissue. They roll outward just a little bit. You also have sort of a chunky base that has these cracks, and it kind of looks like, you know, someone took a bunch of pieces of ice and stuck them together and stuck them in the freezer. And then you have this, you know, really beautiful base, but it definitely is all attached. And so if you hear someone someone refer to a muscaroid base, what they're talking about is this, you know, zoned often two, you know, little layers. You can also see some that ascends up the stem. As far as other identification features for mushrooms that are sort of this muscaroid type, you have big chunky warts on the stem. That is a universal veil remnant. So you do have mushrooms that come up in eggs and basically they burst and they leave these warts on the cap. In this case, they're big, you know, chunky warts. And so that material is pretty robust. A lot of other amanitas, it's very ephemeral. Sometimes it's dusty. Sometimes it's absent entirely. You know, additionally, they're just sort of big and fat and, you know, robust looking. I love the younger ones as well because they have sort of an overall greater wart to cap ratio. So you get these sort of, you know, furry looking mushrooms, which I'm rather fond of. So that's a muscaroid base. So what have we covered so far? We've done volvas. So that's at the base of a lot of our dangerous mushrooms, but also some of our, you know, edible and good species. So we have cups at the base of, say, for instance, Amanita jacksonii and Amanita caesarea group, and they all have cups at the base. So that's one form. Then we have our muscaroid bases with our concentric zones. The third one I'm going to talk to you about is a mushroom that I have been smelling for entirely too long, so I just can't wait to unload myself of it. But this is an Amanita in the Lepidella group. I am not going to commit to a firm ID, but I very strongly suspect that this is Amanita dausipes. Amanitas in Lepidella group are rather large. They tend to be this sort of like off-white color, oftentimes a little yellowy. Many times, like when they're mature, they're these huge white-ish mushrooms that have warts and flakiness, and they smell to high heaven, or at least some of them do. You know, this is a younger specimen, so we haven't had the cap open. But you can see some of the distinguishing features for a Lepidella here. You know, you have wartiness that is a lot more flaky and a lot easier to rub off than, say, the warts I was just looking at with that Pantherina type thing. The thing that makes Lepidellas kind of different besides, you know, their size, color, and smell is that they have a bulbous base. And so instead of having concentric growth zones or a cup, they just basically have a big old bulb. And so this one I broke off. It probably went down another inch or two. When you find a baby one, basically it'll just look like a half of a softball or something with a little, little table tennis ball stuck on the top of it. And you'll pick it and it smells gross and, you know, it's very exciting. But, you know, again, you have bulbous bases and that's a lot more of an amorphous feature. But all that's to say that, you know, once you start to get into the Amanita genus, you'll realize that there's a lot of different forms that they take. But, you know, nonetheless, it really reinforces the need to gather a whole specimen if you're going to, you know, get an Amanita identified accurately or get some help with it. Collecting and photographing or bringing home with you the entirety of the mushroom, inclusive of whatever is at the stem base, is very, very important. So, you know, to conclude, I would consider all of these mushrooms to be toxic. Certainly in the case of this Amanita bisporigera, as you can see, I can handle it and I'm very, you know, happy and comfortable out in the woods. You have to eat this and other toxic mushrooms need to be consumed in order to do you harm. So this is most certainly toxic. As far as the Amanita lepidella, maybe dausipes, you know, most of them have not been tested for toxicity, but they're presumed to be toxic. They smell so bad that I would never be tempted anyway. But, you know, Amanitas in the lepidella section are really cool for photography and not very, you know, I don't recommend under any circumstances eating them. Like, even if you have a choice between grass and lepidellas, you'd probably be safer eating the grass. And then finally, you know, this Amanita here that bears so much resemblance to Muscaria probably is psychoactive and contains compounds that, you know, could cause profuse sweating and disassociation, a variety of other effects. And so, you know, I would consider these sort of on a gradient of all of these are beautiful mushrooms that I'm not going to bring home with me. Except I'm going to document them very thoroughly, so hopefully I can get especially this beautiful warty muscaria type thing out of my dreams and into my ID log of species that I have confidently identified. So now you know more about the bases of Amanita stems, and hopefully that knowledge serves you in your own adventures.